little song we say to welcome our guests. Come on, y'all sing it. Glad you came.
Something meaningful and life-changing to help you move through the challenges of life? Then join Bishop John A. McCullough II and the Friendship Christian Church of Gastonia for an inspirational message prepared just for you.
I think I'll hold on. Is there anybody who, are you determined this morning that I'm going to hold on? Come on, come on. There are a lot of things that happen in life that try to detach you from connections with God and from your faith walk. But will you encourage two people around you and say, I don't know about you, but I think I'm gonna hold on. Come on, it's worth it. Come on, somebody. It's valuable to hold on to God's unchanging hands. It's worth it to continue to stay connected to God. I'm telling you, sometimes sickness and disease comes in and tries to get you to break your hold. Sometimes circumstances and conditions try to get you to loose your hold. But somebody's determined this morning that I'll let nothing, come on, separate me from the love of God. I'm holding. God Almighty, I'm holding. I'm going to stay right there. Come on, I'm going to trust right through it. Anybody been through anything lately that tried to get you to disconnect? Come on, that tried to get you to let go? My God, troubles come that cause you to let go. But the race is not given to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but to he who endureth until the end. Somebody say, I'm going all the way. Come on, I'm going all the way. Enemies and hell's hounds try to get on my trail. Sometimes frustrations try to get me so aggravated that I just want to let go and throw in the towel. But somebody shout, the devil is a liar this morning. I'm holding, I'm holding. Yes, 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 I'm holding. I'm determined to go with Jesus all the way. Somebody say all the way. My God, I've come too far now. Good God. If the devil was going to do anything, he should have done that. He messed around and let me hold on to my hope. He messed around and let me have real joy. Oh, come on, come on. I know, listen, I know you feel it sometimes. Am I right? Come on, choir. Don't sometimes you feel like just letting it go, letting it go. But y'all encouraged us this morning. Hallelujah, that I'm going to hold on. I'm going to hold on. Oh, God, I got to hold on. I've got to hold on. I will hold on. I shall hold on. I'm determined. Bless his name. Glory to his name. Bless his name. Glory to his name. You got to hold on and bless God. And the more you hold on, the more God's working in your favor. Get your Bible if you will. Somebody say, hold on. Come on, you better go ahead and praise him. If you need about 15 more seconds, go ahead and just get your praise in right there. I will yet praise him. Sometimes going and don't feel like it. Sometimes challenged. Sometimes feeling weak. But I'm going. I'm going. All the way. Hey God, I bless your name. Get your Bible if you will. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We bless his name. Hallelujah. We honor him this morning. Hallelujah. The old song used to say, trouble gets in my way, and I have to cry sometimes. Trouble gets in my way and I have to cry sometimes. I've even laid awake at night. My old granny used to say drinking tears for water. But that's all right. I know Jesus. Anybody know him this morning? I know Jesus. I'm not going to say will fix it. I'm going to say has fixed it. Come on, it's manifesting itself even now. It's working to your good right now. He's already fixed it. He fixed it at Calvary. Come on, somebody. I don't have to wait for him. It's already done. There's some things that have to come on to the scene of my experience, but they're already waiting in the wings. Somebody say, my blessing is already done. It's already created. It's already done. God's not having to make anything new. He's not having to come up with anything. Everything that he was going to do has been done. He allows it at different increments to get into your experience, but it's already done. Come on, whenever you hear the Bible say, by his stripes we were healed. Come on, it's already done. Everything for your healing is done. We just got to walk out a manifestation. Get your Bible, turn with us to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel. And go down to chapter number 6. Yes, yes, it is so. I'm holding. You still yet holding? Oh, come on, somebody. You got to say that. You got to talk to yourself. You got to know what to confess when you talk to yourself, because we do talk to ourselves. You just got to say the right stuff. Don't talk what you see. Talk what you believe and expect God to do. 2 Samuel chapter number 6. 2 Samuel chapter number 6. Father, it's in Jesus' name that we honor you and bless you and glorify you. Thank you, God, for how good you are. Thank you, God, for your wonderful and amazing grace. Thank you, Father, for how you continue to cause us to walk in victory. And God, we thank you for this time to worship you. And even now, Father, I pray that you would move me out of the way and usher in the power of the Holy Ghost, that God, you get the glory. Somebody's encouraged. Somebody's built up, God. And I thank you, God, that you will do it to your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Are y'all there? Beginning with verse number 1, it says, again, David gathered all the choice men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, whose name is called by the name the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubim. So they set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, and Uzzah and Ahoah, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, accompanying the ark of God, and Ahoah went before the ark. Then David and all the house of Israel played music before the Lord on all kinds of instruments of fir wood, on harps, on stringed instruments, on tambourines, on sistrums, and on cymbals. And when they came to Nashon's threshing floor, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him there for his error, and he died there by the ark of God. And David became angry because of the Lord's outbreak against Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. David was afraid of the Lord that day, and he said, "How can the ark of the Lord come to me?" So David would not move the ark of the Lord with him into the city of David, but David took it aside into the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. Is that the essence of what your Bible says? This morning, with your prayers and the aid of the Holy Spirit, I want to talk about, I will recover from my mistakes. Grab your neighbor by the hand and look your neighbor in the face and give your neighbor a good firm hand shake and say, neighbor, oh good neighbor, good neighbor, I don't know about you, but I'm decreeing that I will recover from my mistakes. Turn on the other side behind you, get another hand, find somebody else, and say, neighbor, oh good neighbor, good neighbor, I don't know about you, but I declare this day that I will, I shall, I'm going to recover from all my mistakes. Amen. Loose those hands if you receive that today and give God a shout while you take your seat. Hallelujah. Are you determined there? I will recover from my mistakes. When we think about the word mistake, in the noun form, it is an action or a judgment that is misguided or wrong. It is poor reasoning. An action or a judgment that is misguided or wrong, or poor reasoning. It is synonymous with error or fault, or to slip, or to blunder. When you think about mistakes, you think about miscalculations. In the verb form, you're thinking about to be wrong about a particular thing, or to understand wrongly, or to interpret or evaluate wrongly. You can evaluate something that somebody said, and you respond to them, and they jump back, and you say, my bad, I just misunderstood what you were saying. Everyone has made mistakes. Can I get an amen? I said, everyone has made mistakes. Every age person has made mistakes. It does not matter where you're from and who you are and where you are in this phase of your experience in this earth. We can all declare together that we have all made mistakes. We have made and will continue to make mistakes. Am I right this morning? In every area of your life, we will live with the reality that we're going to make some mistakes. The late President Theodore Roosevelt once said, "Show me the person who has not made mistakes, and I will show you the person who has done nothing." Because if you undertake to do anything and to proceed and to succeed, you are going to make some mistakes. Steve Jobs, who was the co-founder of Apple, he said, "Sometimes when you innovate, You make mistakes, and it's best to admit them quickly and get on with improving your other innovations. You're going to make some mistakes. Look at your neighbor's neighbor. You're going to make some mistakes. I know you look perfect sitting in here, and I know that you look sanctimonious, and that you got it all together, and that you have not made some, but you got to understand that we all have made mistakes. Every successful person has experienced making mistakes. Mistakes are broad in their scope. They can be small and minor mistakes, or they can be major, large, and disastrous mistakes. You can make mistakes on your job. You can make mistakes in handling relationships. You can make mistakes in your method of parenting. And you can make mistakes in handling your finances. And even in our spiritual walk, we can make mistakes. Now, I got to qualify it, because a mistake is not necessarily a sin. Every mistake is not necessarily a sin, but a mistake can lead to or place us in the position to sin. I better say that again. I said every mistake is not necessarily a sin, but a mistake can lead to or place us in the position, in the place to sin. It was only a mistake that we went where there was potential trouble. It positioned us to be in a certain place, but it only became sin when we acted or indulged in what was contrary to the word of God. It was not a sin for you to go a certain place, but it depends on what you did when you got to that place that moved it. And then when you recognize that I got messed up in this situation, I realized that it was from the mistake of putting me in the position to be in that place in the first place that opened me up for sin. Now, understand, although all mistakes are not sin, when the mistake placed you and exposed you to sin, rest assured that every sin is a great mistake. We can have great intentions about doing something, and even doing something good for God, and if we aren't careful, it can have sinful and troubling results. Will y'all talk to me? Such is the case this morning when we look at the text. Some of you were here a couple of weeks ago when I preached the message about how we've got to get the glory back. And I referenced back to 1 Samuel, the fourth chapter, and you discover there that there was this ongoing feud between the Philistines and God's people, the Israelites. Every chance they got, it looked like they were fighting one another. They were opposing one another, much like the Democrats and the Republicans are today. And when you look back at 1 Samuel chapter number 4, we discovered that they were in a battle. The Philistines were in a battle against God's people. And they rose up and they became victorious over God's people. The Philistines won. The Philistines won as they fought against God's people. And when they won the battle, guess what happened? They took the Ark of God. They took the Ark of the Covenant from the people of God. Oh, my God. You remember, I explained to you that this is a replica of the Ark of God. And when they were in the battle, the Philistines took the Ark of God. Now, this was the representation of the presence of God. This was the glory of God. This is where God said that I would meet you. And this is the place that they would always know that when the Ark was there, God was in their midst. And so now they have allowed the Philistines to take the Ark of the Covenant. And as a result, the Bible says that that Eli's son, Eli was the priest, and he had two sons, and his sons were killed in the battle. And the news goes to Eli, who was the priest, and he was the one that interceded for the people. And when he found out the news, the Bible said he fell over dead, broke his neck, and then he had a daughter-in-law, and the daughter-in-law was expecting a child. And when the news came to her that her father-in-law was dead, her brother-in-law was dead, or her husband was dead, and the Philistines had taken the ark of God, the Bible says she went into distress and she delivered the baby, and then she died. And the attendant named the baby Ichabod, and Ichabod means no glory. And so we talked about the fact that when God's presence leaves, there is no glory. And so we discover then they lost the glory, and time moved on, and the people desired a king. And God didn't want them to have a king, but he gave them their desire. And they got King Saul. And King Saul ruled and reigned. And then when King Saul died, the Bible said David, God had called Samuel to anoint David earlier. And David is now the king. David is now anointed to be the king, and he was a godly man. You remember that David was a man of faith, and he was a warrior. He believed in God, and one of the first things that David did was David said, we've got to go and get the ark of God and bring the glory to the city of Jerusalem, which was the new capital of Israel. And so David says that we got to go and we got to get the ark of God back. We got to bring the glory back. And so when we go back over to 2 Samuel, chapter number 6, it says in verse 1 that again, David gathered all the choice men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, whose name is called by the name the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubim. So they set the ark of God on a new cart, and it brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, and Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. Now notice they set the ark on the new cart. They were now, when you read verses 4 and 5, the people were properly preparing to worship God. David had sent out the decree that we're getting ready to bring the ark of God back to the holy city, and the people were ready, the band was ready, the musicians were ready, the singers were ready, the people were out there, they were excited about the ark of God coming back. And the Bible says there, when you look at verse number 6, it says, and when they came to Nashon's threshing floor, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. They were coming down a hill and they were trying to be careful, and the ark of God was up on a wagon. And the oxen were leading the wagon. And so they came to this place called a threshing floor. And they threshed out wheat and corn. And it was a rough place. And so the wagon began to wobble. And to assure that the ark didn't fall, one of the sons grabbed it to try to stabilize the ark. Now, let me tell you that the mistake was made when they put the ark of God on a cart. Sometimes our best intentions can go wrongly. Am I right today? Huh? David, at this point, you notice that when the man touched and grabbed the ark of God, the Bible says that God struck him there dead for his mistake, for his error. He died there by the ark of God. Now, wait a minute. Can you see this thing going badly now? Here David has assembled all these people. They have the musicians. They've been singing. They've been praising. And they can see that the oxen are coming down the hill. And the ark of God is on the back of a new cart. They prepared it just for this occasion. And they get to a rough place. And the oxen slip. And the wagon, the cart, begins to stumble and shake. And this man, the natural reaction was to reach out and grab the ark. Hold it so that it does not fall. And because of it, God, the anger of the Lord, the Bible says in verse 7, the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him there. And verse 8 said, and David became angry because of the Lord's outbreak against Uzzah, and he called the name of that place Perez Uzzah to this day. My God. David was angry because of what started out right was now a tragic situation. Any number of things that we do can end up with bad results. Anybody ever started out with a good intention and you ended up with bad results? Am I just talking to the air? Come on, somebody. You can have, there are many things you can think about that there are lost opportunities as a result. That maybe it started out wonderfully and it ended up that you were in a financial crisis. Maybe it started out wonderfully and you ended up in divorce. Maybe you were trying to go about living and you ended up with a pregnancy out of wedlock. Or maybe there's trouble with the law. But there's so many things that we have all experienced that started out feeling right, started out with the right intention, but they ended up badly. There are many who are like David. David was angry now over what happened, when the reality is that it started out as a mistake that we made. All right. David is upset. David is angry with God. David, in his mind, I believe he's saying, I've assembled all of these people. We are celebrating. We're trying to do what's right. We're trying to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to the holy city. And now God has allowed this man to be killed. He took this man's life because this man grabbed the Ark of God. Notice now that the Bible says then that David, in verse 9, was afraid of the Lord that day. And he said, how can the ark of the Lord come to me? He was bewildered. He was confused now. And David, in verse 10, would not move the ark of the Lord with him into the city of David. But David took it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. The ark of the Lord was there. Notice now, the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all of his household. Now it was told King David, saying, the Lord has blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that belongs to him because of the ark of God. So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. Now listen, when we make mistakes that lead to bad situations, we discover that mistakes can either lock you down, they can lock us down, or they can lift us up. Ask your neighbor, say, which one? Which one? Which one? Which one? Which one are you going to choose? A mistake can lock you down, or a mistake can lift you up. It depends on your perspective. It depends upon how you encounter. I told you all of us are going to make them, right? How many have made some mistakes? How many have made some mistakes with some bad results? Come on, somebody. And the reality is that there are a whole lot of people who have made mistakes. They're common, but they have allowed the mistakes to lock them down. They're still stuck in the place of the mistake. They're still living in the regret of the mistake. and they're still beating themselves up because of the mistake. But you got to recognize that that mistake can either lock you down or lift you up. Now, the best thing to do is to declare that I refuse to allow my mistakes to lock me down. Come on, say that. Say, I refuse to allow my mistakes to lock me down. Come on now. Ask your neighbors, neighbor, you're not locked down, are you? See, because whenever you are like those who get locked down, you're missing new opportunities. Am I right this morning? You're missing new relationships. You're missing new joys. And you're missing new places and experiences. Afraid to try again. Afraid of failure. And afraid to step out again. But I wish I could get somebody who would decree in this place, the devil is a liar. I've been stuck in this place too long. I've been stuck in that mistake too long, and it's time for me to rise up. Come on, somebody. It's time for me to rise up. It's time for me to step up out of the place of my mistake, the place of my error, the place of my failure. Do I have about 25 people in here who will decree with me that this is my day? I feel it. I'm getting ready. Come on, because the truth is, sometimes we can't look at you and see that you're stuck in that mistake. Because sometimes you're going on with a smile, but you're stuck. Sometimes you're trying to proceed and you're trying to move, but you're in a stuck place and living with regret. I've learned that you don't need to live with regret. You need to live beyond regret, because all of us, and the truth be told, have made enough mistakes and enough messes and gotten into all kind of quagmire that if the truth be told, the enemy could step on our neck right there and we would still be here. Come on, somebody. You got to decree and determine that I am going to recover from my mistakes. I bet you I have 20 that'll say, oh yeah. Well, the first thing you got to do, you got to do something. Now, the first thing you got to do, you need to retrace your steps. Go back. Go back. I made a mistake. I need to retrace my steps. David was doing a good thing. He was bringing the Ark of the Covenant back. The issue was that the method for carrying the ark was that the Levite carried it by the poles on their shoulders. The proper method had been lost, all right? It had been a lot of years. During Saul's reign, Saul didn't even call for the ark of God to come. He didn't call. Wherever it was being stored, Saul did not even call for it. He did not request. And he did make one feeble request, but then he said, never mind. So during his whole reign, he did not have the ark of God, the presence of God. And David came, and David said, we got to get the ark of God back among the people. But the problem was that David had lost. It had been so long, they forgot about the practice, and the method had been lost. David prepared a good thing, but did not go back and reread the proper way of doing it. We want to honor God, but we got to do it God's way. Come on, somebody. When we fail to keep up the disciplines of God, we will miss out on the benefits. And when God does not bless it, we get angry. Come on, somebody. See, you can't just do it your way. You can't just do it conventionally. You can't do it like the world. See, we want the blessings of God, but we want to worship God and honor God in the way that we want to honor God. And God will tell you that I've got a way, I've got a method, and you got to follow my method if you want my manifestation. Do I have anybody? Huh? And so David forgot about that. David did not use godly instruction. Huh? You got to recognize that negative results will always come without godly instruction. Proverbs 16:9, it says this: in the heart, man plans his ways, But it is God who directs the steps. Come on, somebody. You got to go back, retrace your steps. Look at the things that have been going wrongly. Look at the things that are out of line. Look at the things you've been missing. And maybe you will discover that I have not used godly wisdom. I've not used the instruction of God. I've even tried to do worship God my way, serve God my way, honor God my way. But you got to recognize that when you do it with godly instruction, God promises that he's going to bless it. Is that right? I'm reminded of Psalm 1. Psalm 1 says in verse 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. Come on, somebody. His delight. And in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever, somebody say whatever, and whatever he does shall prosper. Come on, somebody. If you do it God's way, if you use God's instruction, he promised that you will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, and that everything you do is going to prosper. Everything you do is going to go well. I wish you had some. Is there anybody who's ready for your course to change? You've been missing some things that that God promised. Well, it's time for you to prosper and to be blessed, but we got to do it God's way. We can learn even from other people's mistakes and sins and see their consequences and know that I don't need to go down that road. Do I have anybody? God made an example of Uzzah so that there would be no more repeating of the same mistakes. Come on, somebody. We watch people and we see what their experience and outcome is, and we see what they've done. Why is it that we are so crazy to go and do the same thing that they did? Sometimes you don't have to experience it. All you got to do is look at it and say, I don't want any part of that. And so God said, I want to make sure that a standard is set. And he took Uzzah. Uzzah died because he was out of step with God. Go back to the text and you discover that over in verse number 11. Are y'all still here? Verse number 11 there says, the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. Now, and notice this, the B clause, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. Huh? Isn't that the word? The very thing that we attempted, God can show us that it was not that I was angry because you were bringing the ark back, David. It was that you did not use godly instruction. For the ark was blessing Obed-Edom's whole household. I wish I had somebody. That when you got the glory of God in your house, when you got the glory of God in your life, whenever you follow the instructions of God, God will show you that I am here to bless you. I am here to favor you. I am here to prosper you. I want everything you do to go well, but you got to make sure. And so David had become afraid there because of the incident, and he wasn't sure if he even needed to bring the ark, but God gave a confirmation, and because the word came to David that when the ark went down to Obed-Edom's house, Obed-Edom started walking in new blessings. Come on, somebody. Not only him, but his whole household. If you want things to go well in your family, in your marriage, on your job, come on, somebody, with your children, and we've been praying, we've been laying these prayer requests on the altar, we got to line up with God and invite God's glory back into our lives. As for some of us, it was like the people of Israel. We've been going about and we've been experiencing, but the glory is somewhere else. We need to get the glory back into our lives and walk in the plan of God. You got to go back and retrace your steps. David had to retrace his steps and discover where he made his mistake. We all must take a moment and retrace. This is not the time to find someplace or somebody else to blame. See, when things start going wrongly and things start breaking down and it doesn't look like we are prospering, we wanna start doing like 45 and blaming everybody but yourself. Come on, somebody, and find fault in everybody but yourself. It was the Democrats' fault. That's not what I'm talking about. We find fault. It was the wife. It was the husband. We find fault. We want to blame. But you got to go back. David needed to go back and recognize that he had made mistakes and he was going to recover from his mistakes, but he had to retrace his step. Then the second thing I want to tell you is that you got to realign your strategy. You got to realign your strategy. And hope is not a strategy. You just sit up talking about, I sure hope this happens. I sure hope this. I'm hoping this year is going to be a better year. I sure hope things are going to turn around. Hope is not a strategy. You can hope all day long and nothing will change in your life. You got to get you a strategy. Tell your neighbor, you got to get you a strategy. Huh? You got to get you a strategy in order for what you need to happen to happen. Now, God still wants to favor us. God still wants to bless us, but we need to pay attention to the details. David, in verse 12, it says, when it was told to him that Obed-Edom's house was being blessed, it says in the B clause, so David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with gladness. Now, what's going on here? David decided to try again. I told you that your mistake can lock you down or it can lift you up. David spent a little time there. It was 3 months that the ark had been in Obed-Edom's house. And the word came back to David. And David said, you know, it was a tragic situation that happened. That Uzzah was killed. That God took his life there. And it was embarrassing. We had this big celebration going. And it turned disastrous. But David, thank God, David, a man after God's heart, David said, but I know who I am. I know what God called me to do. He said, I know I'm a son of the Most High God. I can't lay here and have a pity party. I can't wallow in my past mistake. I've got to get up. And the Bible said he decided that he was going to try again. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I wonder, will you try again? I wonder, are you bold enough to try it again? Or are you going to just still be stuck? I wonder, will you stand up now and say, even though it was a failure in the past, even though I made a mistake in trying to do it, I wonder, will you say, God, I'm going to trust you again, because I don't want my life to be on lockdown. I don't want to miss out on the glory that you have for my life. I don't want to keep going through and spinning and playing the same record over and over in my mind. I don't want to let my heart cause me to feel like I'm a failure, because I understand that I am fearfully and I am wonderfully made, and I'm determined. I don't know about you, but I'm like David. I'm going to try it again. Yes, I made some mistakes, but I'm not going to live in my past. Is there anybody in here? Don't let your first failure be your final attempt. Go and seek the wisdom of God, and not only the wisdom of God, but find somebody else in that area of expertise to counsel you. Huh? Come on, somebody. You see, our problem is we know everything. Huh? And the further problem is that we don't know that we don't know everything. Huh? Proverbs 11:14 says this: where there is no counsel, the people fail. But in the multitude of counselors, they're safe. I wish I had somebody else. See, you got to recognize. He said that when you got many counsel, when you have several counsel, he says, listen, there is safety, but there is failure when there is no counsel. When you think you know it all, come on, somebody. When you think you know, some of us, my God, it was a shame we learned the alphabet, because now we know everything. You can't tell, my God, just listen, we get a little elevation in our education, and now can't nobody tell us anything, and we get a call on our life and get an anointing, and then we think we know everything. We get married and we think we know everything, don't want to get any counsel, don't want to talk with anybody. He says, but there's safety in the counsel of multitude. David had some of his assistants to go back and look through the archive of the law to find out what the proper strategy was for moving the ark of God. I wish I had somebody. He went back. He said, I've got to learn from this. I'm not going to get stuck right here. I made a mistake, but I know I heard you, God. I know you're moving me by your spirit and by your power. And so I discovered the spirit told him that that putting the ark of God on a new cart was not the way to carry it. All right, he went back, and they went back into the Pentateuch and the law of God, first five books of the Bible, and they pulled out the scrolls, and he searched down through Numbers, and he found in the 15th verse, it says, and when Aaron and his sons have finished covering the sanctuary and all the furnishings of the sanctuary, when the camp is set to go, then the sons of Kohath shall come to carry them, but they shall not touch any holy thing lest they die. Huh? These are the things in the tabernacle of the meeting which the sons of Kohath are to carry. And he goes on, and so he had to discover, he had to retrace his steps, and God showed him that it was a good thing that you were bringing the ark back, but I didn't ask you to put it on a new cart. I told y'all before that they were instructed to put four of those Levites and put this ark under their shoulders and carry it. Only that tribe of people to carry it. God didn't say anything about a new cart. David wanted to do a nice thing. He dubbed it up, put some white walls, and had a new cart fixed up, and he had some 22s on it, and he had that thing polished down. He said, we're getting ready to do this for God. We're getting ready to bring it, and I'm sure he had those tires blacked out, and it was ready. That cart was button-tucked and everything, but that's not the way God said it. I don't care how wonderful you do it, how beautiful you make it. If it's not the instruction of God, you're not going to get the blessing out of it. No need to talk about how much you sacrifice for that, because he would tell you that obedience is better than sacrifice. Do I have two or three? And so David said, we got to get a new strategy. And so the Bible says that David understood that I got to go at it a different way. And some of us this morning, it's not that you're doing badly. It's not that you're doing wrongly, but you got to get a strategy. You got to go back and see why it is. We got to go back and realign our strategy to include the intention of God. If it's not working for you, you need a new strategy. If it's failing, seek God's word, because God's word is sure. We've tried to make it without a godly strategy. We follow all kinds of other means. We've watched other people, but we can't do it like the world. Don't be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You got to go back, and this is the book that we need to follow. Come on, somebody. Right in this book, you'll find every strategy that you need to bless everything that you attempt to do. Do I have anybody? But we want to make this the last place we search. It ought to be the first place you search. When you get ready to get married, this ought to be the first place you search. Huh? But we start searching online and trying to see what they say makes a good man, makes a good woman. You need to see what God said. And if they don't fit that bill, don't accept it. Am I right? Come on, when we get ready to make decisions about life and about careers and changes and directions, we got to seek God. Somebody say, I will recover from my mistakes. And then the final thing that I need to share with you, that you got to make sure that you retrace your steps. And then you got to make sure you realign your strategy. But then the last thing I want to tell you is to rejoice in the success. Tell your neighbor, I'm getting ready to rejoice in my success. Come on, somebody.
Go back over to 2 Samuel, and you discover there in verse number 13, it says, and so it was when those bearing the ark of the Lord, notice, didn't he fix it? It said those bearing the ark. What does bearing mean? Huh? Earlier it said it was on a new cart. But David learned, come on somebody, he would have been foolish to go get another cart. I'm going to try again. I'm going to believe I'm going to do it again. And this time we're going to, maybe I had the wheels were too big. I'm going to drop it to 20. I'm going to take the spinners off. He realigned his strategy. He said that was not the proper method. I got to line up and do it God's way. We fight God. We go against God. And if you're going to get it done, you just might as well go ahead and submit to the way of God. The Bible says in 13, that, and so it was when those bearing the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces that he sacrificed an oxen and fatted sheep. They were celebrating before the Lord. Then David danced. Come on, somebody. Didn't I tell you it's time for you to rejoice in the success? The Bible said David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was wearing a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. David said, all right, boys, it's time to play. He said, all right, organ, it's time to play. He said, all right, people, it's time to celebrate. It's time to rejoice in the God of our salvation. It's time to just bless his name, because we're bringing the ark of God back. And not only are we bringing it back, but we're doing it the way that God said do it. Is there anybody today who's ready to celebrate your new victories? Is there anybody who's ready to give God glory because you're getting some new strategy? David, the Bible says, began to dance, and he recognized that I got to recover from my mistake. I got to recover from my sin. God allowed David to bring the glory back to the holy city. And the Bible said that David danced all over the place. And now when David danced, the type dancing he was doing, he was spinning all around. And the Bible said that his robe was turning, and he was spinning so much until his tunic fell off of him, because he was excited that God was pleased with what he was doing. Is there anybody in here who understands that when you bring God back into your situation, you're going to have reason to celebrate? Is there anybody? David danced, and not only that, David danced and the people praised, because it was now God's business. And you understand that anytime you do it without God, it's dead to try to function without the glory. Don't let the modern culture convince you that you don't need the glory of God. The Bible said David was the new king, and he said, I need your glory. I want your glory. He said, less of me and more of you is what I need. Is that anybody's testimony this morning? Is there anybody who can join in with the writer when he said, I need your glory. I gotta have your glory. I want your glory. More of you and less of me. That's our problem. It's too much of us. Isn't that right? Yeah, I can't be the king without your glory. I can't be a husband without your glory. I can't be a wife without your glory. I can't be a parent without your glory. I can't be an effective employee without your glory. I can't be a proper singer without your glory. I can't be a proper minister without your glory. I can't be a proper deacon without your glory. And too many of us are trying to do it without his glory. But David said, I may have made a mistake in the first attempt. He said, but I am determined that my failure was not final. And I just stopped by to encourage somebody this morning that your failure is not your finality, that you can recover from your mistake. Is there anybody in here this morning who is determined that yes, I made some mistakes, but I shall recover? I'm not going to stay in the same place. And when I recover, I'm going to praise his name. I'm going to bless his
his name, and when I praise his name, when I glorify his name, don't you bother me, because when you begin to celebrate, when you begin to rejoice, let me tell you what you can do. You can silence your critics. You can make those people who are speaking against you shut up. Look at what David did. The Bible said that when David was dancing, he was running all over the city. Come on. He was dancing. I believe he was shouting. I believe he was shouting. Come on, somebody. Anybody got a shout this morning? He was praising. I messed up, but this time God is with me. David was praising. He was dancing. He was twirling. But when you praise, and notice what happened. He said, now as the ark of the Lord, verse 16, came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, David's wife, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and whirling before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. Huh? She started hating on him because he was praising God. Can I tell you, your praise will silence your critics. They can talk about you. They can laugh at you. They can pick at you. But you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know what I went through to experience this glory in my life. Notice. And David was praising God. And David was celebrating. He had a time that he blessed the people. He gave them a piece of food and blessed them and gave them a piece of bread. And then down to verse number 20. David was praising God. He said, but I'm going to go handle this. Then David returned to bless his household. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David. Here she comes. And said, how glorious was the king of Israel today, uncovering himself today in the eyes of the maids of his servants, and as one of the base fellows shamelessly uncovers himself. She's going to try to read him. Because he's praising God, and because God had brought him through that situation. And David said, look at what he said. David said to Michal, it was before the Lord, verse 21, it was before the Lord who chose me instead of your father and all his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore, I will play music before the Lord. And verse 22, he said, and I will be even more undignified than this, and I will be humble in my own sight. But as for the maid servants of whom you've spoken, by them I will be held in honor. Can I tell somebody, don't you let anybody rain on your praise parade. Don't you let anybody cause you to not celebrate the goodness of God. Don't you allow anybody to tell you that it doesn't take all that. You don't know what it took for me. You don't know what God brought me through. You don't know what I've had to deal with. You just see my glory, but you don't know my story. You got to do like David and say, hush your mouth. As a matter of fact, you think that was something, I will praise him even more. I wish I had two or three people who would say, out of all the hell I've been through, I got a reason to praise the Lord. I don't know about you, but it might not take it for you, but I thank God that he has caused me to recover from my mistakes, and I got to give him glory. I've got to give him praise. I've got to glorify his name. Tell them to shut up and take their mouth off of you, because I will give him a praise. He brought me too far. He kept me too long. He could have killed me, but I thank God, and I got to keep on moving. Encourage your neighbor. Say, neighbor, you may have made a mistake, but it's not over until God said it's over. I don't know about you, but I agree with the songwriter. I know the odds look stacked against you, and it seems there's no way out. I know the issue seems unchangeable, and that there's no reason to shout, but the impossible is God's chance to work a miracle, so just know
that it ain't over until God says it's over. You got to keep on fighting until victory is won. He never said it would be easy, but you're a winner in the end. Jesus defeated all your enemies. Why? Before the fight began. But the impossible is God's chance to work a miracle, a miracle. So just know, say, but it ain't over. To God says it's over. You got to keep on fighting. You got to keep on marching. Get up from that mistake and say it ain't over. Get up from that failure and say it ain't final, because God is still working with me. God is still moving me. And when I come out of this, I'm not going to be too cute to bless him. I don't care. I might have to mess up my mascara. I might have to mess up my rouge. I might tear one of my suits. But I got to praise him, because he's too good. He's been better to me than I've been to myself. Say yes. Aren't you glad this morning that God is the God of another chance? They said I wouldn't make it. They said I wouldn't be here. They said I'd never amount to anything. But I'm so glad to say this morning that I'm on my way, and I'm growing more and more each day. There were many who started out with me, but now they've gone astray. But I'm still holding on to God's unchanging hand. He's not through with me yet. Yes, I messed up. Yes, I walked in the wrong place. Yes, I disturbed some stuff. But I'm so glad. If there anybody's got a yet praise, I'm going to praise him. Talk about me if you will. I'm going to bless him. Put your mouth on me if you will. But I got a reason. He's been good. Heal my body. Save my soul. Deliver my children. Bless my household. It's the glory. It's the glory. Somebody say it's the glory. Now give God a praise if you're not too ashamed. Give him a praise if you're not worried about what they say. Give him a praise. He's worthy. He's worthy. Say yes. Say yes. Hallelujah. I don't care what you say. You don't know how good it felt when I came out of the wilderness. I started running and I started shouting. Songwriter said back in the old day that I said I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I couldn't keep it to myself. You ought to been there when he saved my soul. You ought to been there when he made me whole. I started running. I started shouting. And I found no time for doubting, because God. Hallelujah. I wish I had somebody that would give God a praise right here. I wish I had somebody that would give God some glory right here. I made some mistakes, but that ain't the end. Thank God that's not the end. And when you come out, don't come out with a quiet mouth. You come out and let everybody know that it was the Lord. It was God. Raised me up off the sick bed. It was God. Deliver me when death was knocking at my door. It was God that kept me out of the hell hole. It was God. Say yes. Somebody say, I shall recover from all my mistakes. I dare you to give God about 30 seconds of praise right there. Come on. Come on. However you praise him, whatever way you praise him, just give him a glory. Give him a praise wave. Give him a clap. Give him a dance. Whatever you do.
Let them talk about you. Let them say it's ignorant. Let them say it's backward. Oh, it don't take all that. I'm a praiser. Come on, I'm gonna get mine in. I'm gonna bless him. He's too good. He could have left me laying there. He could have left me laying there in that same place. But he raised me, gave me joy, gave me peace. I got a reason, I've got a right, and I got a responsibility. I don't care who it is. Sometimes they're trying to shut down your praise. The world wants to throw so much oppression on you to shut down your praise. Sometimes it comes from even in your own household that wants to disturb your spirit to shut down your praise. But listen, I don't care where what the source is. You can't block this praise. Huh? That's right. David said, matter of fact, I'll dance harder. Huh? I'll praise him more. All that praising stuff, all that's not necessary. When you know that if it had not been for the Lord, mercy, grace, when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul cries hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He brought me, he's kept me. Mistakes. Some lead to sin. Some lead to disastrous results. Even when I'm trying to do something right and noble, it can go very badly. David experienced it. He recognized that I need the glory. We need him. He's not been among us in 30 or 40 years. And I don't want to be the king without the glory. Now, we know that God existed, but it was the representation at that time that they recognized when the covenant was there, they could visibly see and know that God was there. And so David did a noble thing. But he just didn't check first. And he made a mistake, and there were some terrible results. A man's life was lost. David was afraid to move forward. And there are many people who are afraid to move forward, still holding themselves in contempt. There's a video clip that I want to play. There are many people who are stuck. Let me tell you something. You need to realign. You need to go back and retrace your steps. Please remain standing. You can remain standing. Realign your strategy. And rejoice in the success. But many people are stuck at that place.
Because let me tell you, out of all of that, you repent before God and say, God, I messed up. But one thing you got to do is you got to forgive yourself. Some people can't.
Sometimes the hardest person for you to forgive is the one you see in the mirror every day. It's time for you to get free. Sing fire.
I decided to stop replaying regrets, and I decided to tell
everything in
my past goodbye. I cannot change what I did,
no.
But it didn't change what you gave when you took my place. No more guilt but grace.
Time to let it go.
Held on way too long, watching reruns of my road take the shame away.
No more
reliving mistakes you washed away.
So I want you to do what God has already done for you and say,
I forgive me.
It may have taken a while to get to this point, but
I forgive me.
If God has forgiven you, why can't you do the same?
I forgive me.
It's time to stop looking back so God's purpose can move you forward.
I forgive me.
You may be saying, James, but you don't know my past. I was wrong.
Yeah, I know it was wrong.
Carry this weight.
Carry this weight for too long.
I want you to get free right now and say,
I forgive me.
You've been hard on yourself long enough.
I forgive me.
You've always felt like you weren't good enough, but that's over. You've made mistakes, but those mistakes don't get to make you.
I forgive me.
God knew what you'd do, and he still chose you.
Yeah, I know it was wrong. Carry this weight for too long.
But you've been carrying this weight for far too long.
I forgive me.
Now letting go can be the most difficult part of this process. To have a memory of your past, but not allow those memories to produce the same pain in your future. But today, it's time for you to get your life back. Instead of staying down, feeling sorry for yourself, I want you to pick yourself back up and let it go.
I'm letting it go.
The pain of yesterday.
I'm letting it go.
You've already taken too much from me.
You won't steal my future anymore.
Mistake.
I'm letting it go.
It's time to receive God's grace. You can't change his mind about you anyway.
You won't steal my future anymore.
You could have been a better mother.
I'm letting it go.
And maybe you should have been a better father. So pick up the phone and call that child. It's not too late.
You won't steal my future anymore.
It's time to let go of the shame.
I'm letting it go.
The stuff they put on your name.
Let me go. If you let me go this morning, the devil won't steal your future anymore. Come on. Is there anybody who says, I'm getting beyond my mistakes? I'm getting beyond all those things that I've done wrong. I've been held in that place of bondage too long. I got to let it go this morning. Come on. I got to forgive me. Somebody say, I got to forgive me. That if you're going forward, you got to forgive yourself. You're still angry at yourself. It's been 10 years. It's been 15 years. It was last week. God said that if you're going to recover, you must retrace your steps. You must realign your strategy. And you ought to rejoice in the success. But none of those things will become a reality until you forgive you. God says, I'll forgive you. But you got to forgive you. And when you forgive yourself, you can move forward with a new way of moving. I'm not going to let it, anybody determine. I'm not going to let it keep me in bondage anymore. I've got to go forward. I got to go forward. I made a mistake. I sinned. I came short. And I might do it again potentially, but I'm living not to, but I understand my humanity. But right now, I want to pray for somebody this morning to be released. Lift your hands right now. If you know that you're determined, I'm recovering from this thing. It might be a simple thing or it might be a major disastrous thing. The scope is wide. Father, in Jesus' name, we are just like David. We have had many failures and shortages and mistakes. And some led to sin. Some led to transgression against your law and your word. But we thank you that you're a loving Father. You're a forgiving Father. And that, God, you just asked us to go back and retrace, to take a look at where I went wrong. Where did I let myself get positioned in the wrong place, around the wrong people, and in the wrong perspective that I messed up? Father, I recognize where it is, and I got to go back. I got to fix it. I got to change it. And then, God, so I got to realign my strategy. I got to change. I can't keep doing what I've been doing to expect new results. But, Father, give me a new strategy. Give me a word-oriented strategy. And then, God, when you do it, I will rejoice in the success. I'll call it you. I'll say it's your glory. It was not me, God, not by might nor by power, but by your spirit, said the Lord of hosts. Father, I thank you that you will release some people this morning. They've been struggling. They've been in pain. They've been challenged trying to go forward, but God, they haven't even forgiven themselves. They still walk in condemnation. They still walk in guilt. You have already erased it, but they're still walking in guilt. And they're missing opportunities. They're missing open doors. They're missing even your using them to your glory. So today, God, it's done. We decree it right now that we're letting it go so we can go to new heights. No longer are we going to be locked down, but we're going to new places. No longer are we going to be held in the same bondage. But you, the Bible says, those in whom the Son has set free are free indeed. God, help them to walk and experience your freedom, and help them to rejoice and celebrate and praise you. And we give you honor. We give you glory. It's in Jesus' name. We praise you now. And if everybody's in agreement, give God a praise right there. Hallelujah.
If you're looking for dynamic worship, inspirational teaching, and a friendly atmosphere, you can visit us on Sundays at 221 West Bradley Street in Gastonia, North Carolina. For more information about our ministry, you can call 704-865-9016. To order your personal copy of today's message or any other broadcast, please call 704-865-9016 and indicate the broadcast date. Or you can just visit us online at www.friendshipgastonia.com. Thank you for tuning in to today's broadcast with Bishop John A. McCullough II and the Friendship Christian Church. Make sure you join us next week at the same time. And remember, let God take control and let the Spirit flow.